I too start with a group of people who assembled in Berlin to look at the Neues Museum shortly after the wall had come down. Shortly in Germany means the wall came down in 87. The first competition which David Chipperfield and myself were involved with was in 95. We came second in that, disappointingly. But then were invited to come back for a second competition in 1997. These great projects mean that a great number of people are involved. And I just thought we would start with the team. On my left, of course, is David Chipperfield, and on my right, Sascha Schwarz, the chief director of design at David's office. We start with the context. It's we're building on an island in the middle of the River Schrei, and the whole point of this museum is that it was to serve as a repository for the collection of the Prussian nation and to re-establish it as one of those central places in Europe where, as you see on the right hand, you have Unter den Linden coming down to a castle, then you have the cathedral next to that, and beyond that you have the... So, we have Unter den Linden, we have castle, we have cathedral, the old museum, which was where the first collections were assembled, and then the site of the new museum, which is built here. This is the post office building where water transport provided access to the rest of the world. I've got 12 years' work to go through in 25 minutes, so from now on, I'm going to come at you pretty fast and then invite you at the end if there are things which you don't perhaps appreciate or want me to expand on. On the right, you have this vision of the Athens of the North, this idea that this would be a great commemorative collection of antiquities assembled by the nation. So it compares with the Louvre or the British Museum. On the left-hand side, those utilitarian buildings which serve the commercial uses of the city and the barges of the city which serve the waterways to provide access and ingress. The building as we found it was in a sad condition. On the left-hand side, you see this great occlusion of red brickwork right in the center. That was a means of stabilizing two old pieces of wall into one. And on the right-hand side, you can see how that's been done in a very conventional way, but with a brick which is totally foreign to the brick of which the building was constructed. And so what we have here is engineering brick put in place of stock brick. There were 18 different brick makers to make up the bricks for the original building. And what does that tell us? It tells us that there was this presupposition that the great tradition built in Potsdam of re-establishing the Beaux-Arts tradition of reconstruction, this building was to be put back exactly as it had been before it was destroyed. It was a nice irony that David and I were the grandchildren of those who sadly made the mess in the first place. And it was something of a pride and moral duty for us to try and tidy up what our grandfathers had done. We've spoken about, and we all know about, the industry of conservation plans. Well, here we had to invent a particular set of documentation. On the right-hand side, we have this sorting out of what all those words beginning with R mean. What is repair, restoration, renovation, rehabilitation? And certainly the dictionaries on the table were at least 6 inches thick to get the English and German into some coordinated fashion. Then, of course, we have the concepts. What are you going to do with 20 galleries which show a variety of destruction from complete survival to complete wreckage and indeed denigration of the whole substrate? And then, how are you going to put strategies together which will actually make a sense of what this building is? And the curators were very clear. Julian, we don't want you to have been here when you finished. I said, thank you very much. It's nice of you to keep inviting me. I'll come every 3 weeks, as I did for 12 years. And when I go, you won't know I've been here. They said, that would be delightful, because we have a collection to put in this building, and we don't care how much you worship it. But we want it to serve as an enclosure for our collections. You can understand that the debates were long and involved, and there's no meeting in Berlin that can have less than 12 people, usually 16 or possibly 20. Just the essence of what we decided between us quite early on to do. On the right-hand side, you see that it's a central Treppenhaus staircase. It's the first multi-story museum in Europe, so you have three museums on top of another, as originally built in 1843. The southeast risalit with the little arrow on here is introduced to take its place again to allow the circulation around the central courtyard, and in the same way the northwest L shape is to be reinstated. So new was, yes, new and is very beautiful new modern architecture, but it was subservient to the idea of what survived as a room. And one of the things we say is that we had to almost take the 60% that survived and ruinate it. What I mean by that is that red brickwork all had to come out and to be replaced with second-hand salvage stock brickwork put in lime mortar, so there was a congruity of structure between old and new. On the left-hand side is one of the visions to create within the northern courtyard a new framework supporting the roof, which would provide a chapel or special place within the new museum. The extent of decay. On the lower left-hand side, we can see that you have a complete survival. Then you have a partial survival, and then all the decoration is gone. Here you have the appearing of the substrate below that, sometimes hollow pot, sometimes brickwork. And here you have the pots have actually lost their integrity, and they absolutely depend as pots. They're like a terracotta pot with a lid and a top. In the same way, we have to look at the materials of which the building is built. It took from 1843 to 1865 to construct, and so you have 20 galleries, each taking about a year to construct. On the left-hand side, granite, which has got a saline bloom on it, and here's a repolishing exercise just to establish in our minds, yes, we could repolish it. On the right-hand side, great shaft of Silesian sandstone with the flutings which were to form the basis of a marble cement procedure, which in England we call something like Keene cement. It's obviously a plaster which has engaged within it marble dust to give it an iridescent surface. On the left-hand side, some of the iconography surviving within the building. The Egyptian galleries were given an Egyptian hieroglyphic painted ceiling made on 20-inch square, 600 square sheets of paper. And those were here, you can see, spotted with white dots, and that was when in 1929 a new collection of Egyptian material came in, and these are where the hangers were put for the false ceiling which covered this material. There's a very rich story of artwork paintings which runs around as a frieze in each gallery to give you a didactic basis to the exhibits which you're to observe. And that truly was one of the anxieties of the curatorial team, that we hand back to the 19th century museum unable to accommodate 20th century interpretation of a classical tradition which didn't stop in 1865. Needless to say, that has been possible, but it means taking those paintings and dealing with them as a conservation element in the fabric of the building. On the left-hand side, the sculptural elements, in their innocent form, and for us in a very easy way to deal with. There they are, you start work immediately, but also much more difficult to deal with. On the right-hand side, you can see a stucco sculpture which has actually been repaired in a neorealistic tradition. Locked behind the wall dividing Germany and therefore somewhat isolated from the rest of the world. And therefore that was one of the areas where we were talking about this question of re-ruination. In other words, we took out that material and replaced it in a manner which we believe has more congruity with the way in which we dealt with the innocent material on the left-hand side. The question of floors. This building has had 1.2 million visitors since it reopened 3 years ago, and the floors could be dealt with in a whole series of ways. We could put false carriageways over them, as some cathedrals do, but in the end we decided the floors were, as on the left-hand side, are made of materials that could take an enormous number of visitors if we were certain the substrate was sound. It wasn't sound, and I'll show you in a moment how we discovered that. It's very simple radar analysis. On the right-hand side, we have a porphyry floor, which has been subjected to rainwater from 1945 to 1987, and when the false roof was put on. And there we took that material, remixed it, and relaid it and repolished it. So that's more of an intervention than perhaps one might be conventionally familiar with adopting. But this sheer pressure of, do we close the museum and have a few visitors, or does it once more have to become one of the monuments visited in Europe as part of this triumvirate? Great lacuna on the left-hand side, a bridge which takes you in a pedestrian route across spaces where the floors have collapsed. The judgment, should we leave it like that and just put bridges across the lacuna? But it was absolutely clear that this was not the wish of the curatorial team. They wanted their galleries back. And indeed, through the heroic efforts of many people, all the columns for that particular colonnade all survived in storage. So did all the brickwork and other elements, which enabled us to convincingly say to ourselves, yes, there's the material, we could put it back. On the right-hand side, and a little bit more difficult, was what to do with these clay pots. Of course, there was this, well, they don't conform to DIN standard. And then there was the, well, you can't get them anymore. And so what I did was to have three made in England and put them on the table. And immediately there was a proposition, if you can do it, we can do it too. And so the Berliners went and they found a potter who was adept, and he made 10,000 of these little pots. And then the engineer said, but it's not going to be strong enough. So what we did was to have prototype a whole series of vaults and arches, and then test them to destruction. Rather than trying to use calculation to say how strong they were, we said they were. It's 18 kilonewtons that they failed, and so we said, well, there you are, you can have a 3-ton safety factor on those floors for museum loading. And they said, thank you very much, we're so pleased you brought us a piece of paper. Well, we did, but it was at some expense. I want to just make this connection with a commission which we have enjoyed for 25 years with the Sir John Soane Museum. This is Pitshanger Manor. The point in doing this is, there is a shallow dome similar to those which you'll see in the Neues Museum, and Stuller and Schinkel both came to visit Soane in 1825, and therefore there was a correspondence of ideas and techniques across Europe at this time, which perhaps replicates what we're trying to do here today. So it's very nice to feel that Herr Stuller and Herr Schinkel would visit and greet Sir John Soane, and just as we're able to visit and greet one another here from different parts of the world. The massive walls of the museum, built on an island in the middle of the river, on the left-hand side, it's very clearly shown how you've got these enormous walls, and they had sunk by 450 millimetres into the mud of the river. And therefore they were saying, how can we make a lightweight floor? Well, that was where the pots became available, because Sir John Soane was using pots in the same way at the Bank of England. And therefore, that's not to mean they were the only two people in Europe using it, but what I'm saying is that there's a congruity of knowledge. What there wasn't quite such a shared knowledge about was how to make iron. And so all this iron, this is a bowstring in compression, and then wrought iron in tension, all that came from Ironbridge, down the River Severn, then up the Spray, and then was used in the building here in Berlin. This decoration, which you'll see later on, is a great tradition in Berlin of zinc sculpture. In London, we would think of bronze sculpture as being a way of making a cast from plaster maquette, but here zinc was used very effectively. On the right-hand side, you can see the form of the Schopenhauer, this staircase which gets you terribly gently from one floor to the next, so that the three museums are entered. This is the vestibule, and that gets you to the ground floor. Then you come up, and then there's a chamber here, the Bacchusel, which gets you up here. And the ship, you can just see an erection here, a symbol of the ascendancy of Greek technology, Greek classicism, as the porte cochere to the upper of the three museums. And then on the walls you get tapestries which again give you the context of the various religious bases for the collections which you're to see. Oops, let's just go back. This is Schinkel's diary, because after visiting Soane, he went to Manchester to look at the mills to see how they were constructed, where you've got these massive walls by the River Irwell, which had sunk down into the mud there, and what sort of floors did they use there. And that's where this idea of bowstring iron construction and pot originated. On the left-hand side, we have the great focus for the short-term tourists coming to the Neues Museum at Titi's Head. And one saw yesterday how carefully choreographed are the visits of different sort of categories of visitors to the museum. And this head had to be placed where a coach could arrive, debouch its visitors, they could go and see Nefertiti, come back, buy a postcard, and be back in their coach within about 25 minutes. I'm sympathetic to the rush which they are pressed by. On the right-hand side, you have some of the animalistic collection, which allows a more leisurely visit to the museum. Sir John Soane's museum, the yellow light coming through, that Mediterranean light to illustrate his collection of objects. A museum where one hopes that our presence has gone unnoticed. The ruined interior of the museum, on the left-hand side, the Chinese paper applied on the wall paintings. The wall paintings set the character for the room. Repair those first and the rest will fall into place. At the head, you can see some of that zinc sculpture I talked about, enriching the structure of the bowstring arch. On the left-hand side, you can see the radar analysis of that floor, which shows the first and second layers of underscreen, and on the right-hand side, the consolidation of the surface of the rendered exterior of the building. And then, what are we going to do with this pattern of wanton destruction? On the left-hand side, how we found it, with the red bricks bottom right, and also with great distress to some of the architectural framework to the wall painting. So on the right is just a photoshopped experiment to say, well, what happens if we put that back? What happens if we conclude this architrave and restore that? And then suppose we're not interested in this line of decay. Suppose we say that that's actually the least relevant part of the issue, and therefore can we cloud that with a colour wash which suppresses the decay to the point where you're not overwhelmed by decay, but you begin to see beyond the decay to what the original inventor and artist intended. On the outside of the building, a similar approach. You can see here the render of the outside, and this is blocks of render, but it has fine dust rubbed into it of pink, beige, and brown in order to make it look like Silesian sandstone. And then between, you've got the brick substrate, and what we did here was to slurry that so that the tonal colour of the surviving material and the substrate were similar, and instead of being contrasting, these are little zinc figures put back, and we also indulged ourselves in rebuilding this portion with some surviving stonework around these windows, so that we could provide a decent and proper line which then abutted the new reconstruction of the southeast risalit. In other words, we're intervening in the ruin of the building in order to make it capable of accepting its neighbourly new intervention. Within the great space, David designed this fantastic staircase, which was based on Stuhler's original. There were many variations considered earlier, but I would say it is so comfortable that when Prince Philip and Her Majesty the Queen came to visit, the Queen took it at one go, and that's the horseman for you. She just didn't stop, and everybody else was sort of, when is she going to stop? Well, she didn't. She took the whole flight. And that's fantastic tribute to the skill of the 19th century designer, that stair is just comfortable enough for you to ascend up to the first floor level. We were able to persuade the museum to put this arcade back. These columns were in storage. This is all the second-hand brick, which is another story. But what it enabled us to do was to maintain the circulation route across the Chapman Hallett and therefore complete the circuit. This is the new roof over the top of the whole chamber, and I hope you can't see it, but there is a join right the way down there where we took out red brick from that. This is terracotta made in Poland, coal-fired terracotta, not terracotta that's made with a gas-fired kiln, but it has all that variation which arises from using coal-fired kilns. New interventions too, where they had disappeared. On the left-hand side, this is Sasha's new bay. replicating the one which had been destroyed, and 66 figures of the Schiffenbein frieze figurative plaster, again that reconstruction after perhaps a different sort of repair earlier on. On the left-hand side, the rotor cell, and on the right-hand side, those coffers which you've seen at the beginning with their context. On the right-hand side, the main chamber where we restored the columns, and in the middle, the column with the new stone from the same quarry from which the old stone had come, inserted in a very vertical manner, and then on the left-hand side, the emission and new floor introduced. The reduction on the left-hand side of the size of the oculus, which had been enlarged in the 1870s, so that the wall paintings to be reinstated were given their proper natural lighting context, and Sasha's new Osthaus, as I think of it, on the right-hand side, representing that which had been lost through bombing. The interiors of the museum, putting the mouldings back, so the mouldings of the architecture divided each chamber into a series of divided portions so that you could move from the far end where you've got total survival of a Pompeian scheme of direction to half repaired and then beyond and out of the picture to total repair. The cleaning of this material was extremely difficult because in East Germany they'd applied epoxy resin to all that material and they'd done it before they cleaned it. So all the dirt which obscured the decoration presented a great technical problem. On the left-hand side, the removal of a partition and the way in which we dealt with that repair. On the right-hand side, looking through to the National Gallery, where there is a staircase which replicates that which is internal, inside. So there's one staircase which is outside and another staircase is inside. So the inside staircase is a landscape staircase. Just here, quickly, the retention of shrapnel damage, because while the Brits bombed from the air, the Russians fought their way through from the east, and this is a necessary memorial to the horrors of war. On the left-hand side, the Neobiedensaal. After those wall paintings have been repaired, the damage to the ceiling is still evident. You can see the patchiness in the red. On the right-hand side, great chambers and tombs have been removed, and therefore the decoration's discontinuity is telling part of the story of what's been removed. They gave me a little room because I said, you are not going to put all this paraphernalia back all over the museum where it happens to have survived. And so what we did was create a lapidarium for those pieces which would have been disturbing and distressing to the presentation of the new material that was to go into the museum. So everybody who's got a restoration project, please identify a lapidarium for those bits and pieces which are necessarily left over. On the left-hand side, the shallow domes, which you've seen in Sir John Soane's sketch. On the right-hand side, that wall which we tentatively showed you before. You can see that I didn't win my argument about the green wash over there, and they used, in fact, a grey cement. I'm quite content with that. Just trying to argue that through with 12 or 16 people was quite enough, thank you very much. And then the day the people came in, we opened for one weekend and 30,000 visitors came to see what we've been doing behind the plastic. This on the right-hand side is what I'd call this chapel, this new chamber. And then the undercroft, which had been underpinned, the, on the right-hand side, the cases designed with Michele De Luca, and on the left-hand side, yes, I have finished. On the left-hand side, part of the restoration with the natural light coming from the west, and on the right-hand side, one of the David's new galleries, showing artificial light in Professor Bilbin's fantastic collection of Egyptian heads. And so with that, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you deserve lunch.